These were my earliest letters from Emily Dickinson, in their order. From this time and up to her death, May 15th, 1886, we corresponded at varying intervals, she always persistently keeping up this attitude of scholar and assuming on my part a preceptorship which it is almost needless to say did not exist. Always glad to hear her recite, as she called it, I soon abandoned all attempt to guide in the slightest degree this extraordinary nature, and simply accepted her confidences, giving as much as I could of what might interest her in return. Sometimes there would be a long pause on my part, after which would come a plaintive letter, always terse, like this. Did I displease you? But won't you tell me how? Or perhaps the announcement of some event vast to her small sphere, as this. Amherst, E. Dickinson. Carlo died. Would you instruct me now? Or sometimes there would arrive an exquisite little detached strain, every word a picture like this. The hummingbird. A root of evanescence, with a revolving wheel, a resonance of emerald, a rush of cochineal, and every blossom on the bush adjusts its tumbled head. The mail from Tunis, probably, an easy morning's ride. Nothing in literature, I am sure, so condenses into a few words that gorgeous atom of life and fire of which he here attempts a description. It is, however, needless to conceal that many of her brilliant fragments were less satisfying. She almost always grasped whatever she sought, but with some fracture of grammar and dictionary on the way. Often, too, she was obscure and sometimes inscrutable, and though obscurity is sometimes, in Coleridge's phrase, a compliment to the reader, yet it is never safe to press this compliment too hard. Sometimes, on the other hand, her verses found too much favor for her comfort, and she was urged to publish. In such cases, I was sometimes put forward as a defense, and the following letter was the fruit of some such occasion. Dear friend, thank you for the advice. I shall implicitly follow it. The one who asked me for the lines I had never seen. He spoke of a charity. I refused, but did not inquire. He again earnestly urged on the ground that in that way I might aid unfortunate children. The name of child was a snare to me, and I hesitated, choosing my most rudimentary and without criterion. I inquired of you. You can scarcely estimate the opinion to one utterly guideless. Again, thank you, your scholar. Again came this on a similar theme. Dear friend, are you willing to tell me what is right? Mrs. Jackson of Colorado was with me a few moments this week and wished me to write for this. A circular of the No Name series was enclosed. I told her I was unwilling, and she asked me why. I said I was incapable, and she seemed not to believe me and asked me not to decide for a few days. Meantime, she would write me. She was so sweetly noble I would regret to a stranger. And if you would be willing to give me a note saying you disapproved it and thought me unfit, she would believe you. I am sorry to flee so often to my safest friend, but hope he permits me. In all this time, nearly 8 years, we had never met. But she had sent me invitations like the following. Amherst. Dear friend, whom my dog understood, could not elude others. I should be so glad to see you, but think it an apparitional pleasure not to be fulfilled. I am uncertain of Boston. I had promised to visit my physician for a few days in May, but father objects because he is in the habit of me. Is it more far to Amherst? You will find a minute host, but a spacious welcome. If I shall entreat you to teach me, are you much displeased? I will be patient, constant, never reject your knife, and should my slowness goad you, you knew before myself that, except the smaller size, no lives are round. These hurry to a sphere and show an end. The larger, slower grow and later hang. The summers of Hesperides are long. Afterwards came this. Amherst, dear friend, a letter always feels to me like immortality because it is the mind alone without corporeal friend. Indebted in our talk to attitude and accent, there seems a spectral power in thought that walks alone. I would like to thank you for your great kindness, but never try to lift the words which I cannot hold. Should you come to Amherst, I might then succeed, though gratitude is the timid wealth of those who have nothing. I am sure that you speak the truth, because the noble do. but your letters always surprise me. My life has been too simple and stern to embarrass any. Scene of angels, scarcely my responsibility. It is difficult not to be fictitious in so fair a place, but tests severe repairs are permitted all. When a little girl, I remember hearing that remarkable passage and preferring the power, not knowing at the time that kingdom and glory were included. You noticed my dwelling alone. To an emigrant, country's idol except it be his own. You speak kindly of seeing me. Could it please your convenience to come so far as Amherst, I should be very glad, but I do not cross my father's ground to any house or town. Of our greatest acts, we are ignorant. You are not aware that you saved my life. To thank you in person has been since then one of my few requests. You will excuse each that I say, because no one taught me.